Okay. Welcome, everybody. We're very happy to have Professor Alessandra Lunardi as our next plenary speaker. Alessandra is professor at the Università di Parma. She studied at the Scuola Normale Superiore in Pisa under Giuseppe da Prato, and she left Pisa in 1983. When she took up a ricercatore position at Pisa itself until 87. Then she was a professor, faithful professor at the Università di Cagliari, where she stayed until 1994 and left and is currently at Università di Parma. She went from Cagliari to Parma and she's there to date. Alessandra Lunardi has written two books, Interpolation Theory and Analytic Semigroups and Optimal Regularity in Parabolic Problems. And she's written over 80 papers in some of the best research journals in analysis and PDE. She's on the editorial board for Evolution Equations and Control Theory, for the Journal of Evolution Equations, for the Journal of Mathematical Analysis and Applications, for the Rivista di Matematica dell'Università di Parma, and for the Journal Analytic Geometry and Number Theory, and also for NODEA, Nonlinear Differential Equations and Applications, of which she was managing editor between 2010 and 2013. Her main research interests are Kolmogorov equations, parabolic problems, and evolution equations with time in all of R. So it's a great pleasure to have Alessandra speaking to us today, and the title of her talk is Surface Measures in Banach Spaces.
So thank you for the Thank you for the introduction, and many thanks to organizers for inviting me. I'm going to talk about a subject which is not very popular, and in fact, I studied these subjects only since a few years. And, well, no, it doesn't work. I need help. Maybe I use this one. Okay. So the ambient space is a Banach space endowed with a Borel probability measure. And what we want to do is to define reasonable surface measures such that there exists integration by parts formula, at least for good functions on good domains. And, well, which is our finite dimensional model, our finite dimensional examples. It is not the Lebesgue measure, because it's well known that in infinite dimensional spaces there is no analog of the Lebesgue measure, no translation invariant measures such that measure of any ball is positive. Instead, there are Gaussian measures. So our finite dimensional model is the standard Gaussian measure in RD. So this is the Gaussian weight, and the X is the Lebesgue measure. And then in this case, we have for every open set with smooth boundary and for every element h in RD different from zero, and for every sufficiently regular function, this integration by parts formula, the integral over omega of the derivative of f in the direction of h is equal to the this term, which comes from differentiating by parts, integrating by parts the Gaussian weight, plus a boundary integral, which is the scalar product between the exterior normal vector to the boundary and h by f by this measure, which is the Gauss weight by the Hausdorff did minus one dimensional measure in RD. This is very trivial. This is a trivial formula. What we want to do is to do something possibly similar to this also in infinite dimensions. And in infinite dimensions, what is difficult, what was not easy at all, is to construct surface measures. And there are different constructions with different methods. And they started, I think, with Skorohod many years ago, who was followed by many people from the Russian school. But I think that the main and most important contributions were given by French mathematicians. In particular, Hérault and Malliavin considered a very special situation. X was the space of the continuous functions on an interval that vanish at zero, and gamma was the Wiener measure, a very explicit measure. And they constructed surface measures, not everywhere, on the level sets of good functions through an original procedure, which is called the image measures approach. And then, after some years, Feyel and de La Pradelle considered the case of a separable Banach space endowed with a good Gaussian measure, then I will define. And they constructed a one-codimensional Hausdorff measure on all the Borel sets of X through finite-dimensional approximations. So let me describe a bit the approach. And before I had, since these constructions were made for Gaussian measures, I have to introduce some definitions and important objects in this context. So X is a separable Banach space, and gamma is a good Gaussian measure. An important object is the Cameron-Martin space, which is a subspace of X that I'm going to describe. So first of all, what's a Gaussian measure? Is a Borel probability measure such that for each element of the dual space, the induced measure on R, B is any Borel set in R, this induced measure is just gamma of F minus 1 of B, is a Gaussian measure in R. And it's called the centred if the integral of every element of the dual space is zero. It's called the non-degenerate if its support is the whole space X. So what is H? The Cameron-Martin space is the set of all elements, H in X, such that the translated measure, gamma of A minus H, is absolutely continuous with respect to gamma. Now here we face an important difficulty in infinite dimensions. In contrast with what happens with the Lebesgue measure, the measure does not behave well under diffeomorphisms, and in particular under translations. And the shifted measure in general is not absolutely continuous with respect to the original measure gamma. We have to introduce this subset H of X. And it's possible to characterize it. It is the subset of all elements H in X such that there exists an element of X star, or more generally of the closure of X star in L2, that makes this job. For every element F in X star, F of H is equal to the scalar product in L2 of F by H hat. And it is a Hilbert space with the scalar product between H and K given by the scalar product in L2 of these two functions, H hat, K hat. Why do I introduce this characterization? Because these functions, H hat, are what appear in the integration by parts formula. And the integration by parts formula, let me start with here. For every H in the Cameron-Martin space and for every good F, C1B means bounded C1, namely Fréchet differentiable at every point with derivative with bounded norm. And we have this equality. And recall that in the finite dimensional case, when we have gamma is the standard Gaussian measure, H hat of X is just the scalar product between H and X. So we have this generalization. Now I need also to introduce Sobolev spaces with respect to these measures. And I will use strong derivatives. just consider a function in C1B and x in the space x. Then f prime of x, the Fréchet derivative, is by definition an element of x star. But h, this I didn't tell you, h is continuously embedded in x. And so x star is continuously embedded in h star. And then there is a unique element v of h such that f prime of x applied to h is equal to the scalar product between v and h. And v is denoted by h gradient of f at x. So what we have is a sort of Taylor development, first order Taylor development, but only in the directions of h. This works only in the directions of h, for increments in h. And then what happens is that this operator, gradient h, is seen as an unbounded operator in LP with domain these good functions C1b and with values in LP x gamma with values in h is closable. And then W1p is the domain of the closure of this gradient, this h gradient, and the closure is still denoted by h gradient. And so W1p is a Banach space with the graph norm of this operator, which is the Sobolev, the usual Sobolev norm. And by construction, C1b is dense in W1p. So an element of W1p is a function in LP, such that there is a sequence of C1b functions that converge to f in LP, and such that their gradients, their h gradients, are bounded in this norm. Okay, now the spaces WKP are defined similarly. And so we can define the strong derivative of F in the direction of H for every H in the Cameron-Martin space and for every F in the W1P space, just as the scalar product between the h gradient of f at x and h. And the integration by parts formula holds also for Sobolev functions. We have the same formula that we had for C1b functions for elements in any Sobolev space. This is just because we approach f by a sequence of C1b functions, and we can easily pass to the limit in the integral. Okay, now how can we construct a surface measure? This is the construction of Feyel and de la Pradelle. We start with a finite dimensional case when F is Rm, and we define the measure theta F as the Gaussian weight in Rm by Hm minus 1, which is the spherical m minus 1 dimensional Hausdorff measure in Rm. And the spherical Hausdorff measure is defined as the usual Hausdorff measure. Only the coverings of the Borel set B that we want to measure are made by balls. Okay, and so in infinite dimensions, what we do? We fix a finite dimensional subspace F of the Cameron-Martin space, and we can identify it with Rm in a trivial way. And so that exists, it's a closed subspace of H, and so there exists the orthogonal projection from H to F. And it's possible to extend it as a projection pi F, which is defined in the whole space. And then X can be decomposed as the direct sum of F plus this complementary subspace F tilde. And this is important, an important feature of the Gaussian measures, that this decomposition induced a decomposition of gamma. Namely, gamma is the product of two Gaussian measures, gamma F, a Gaussian measure on F, and gamma F tilde, which is a Gaussian measure in F tilde. And in fact, gamma F, if we identify F with Rm, can be seen as the standard Gaussian measure in Rm. And well, we take any Borel set A in X, and we define capital theta F of A as the integral over F tilde of small theta F of AX integrated with respect to this measure gamma F tilde. AX is just the section of A for every X in F tilde. So if we were in finite dimensions, this would be just a way to compute the Hausdorff dimension, the Hausdorff measure of A using the Fubini theorem and nothing else. In infinite dimensions, this depends on the F that we choose. And a nice aspect is that this theta F is increasing. Namely, if you have two subspaces, F2 that contains F1, then for every A, theta F2 of A is bigger or equal than theta F1 of A. And so we can define the Hausdorff-Gauss measure by the supremum. Rho of A is the supremum of all these capital theta F of A when F arises on all the finite dimensional subspaces of H. With this measure, we have an integration by parts formula, at least on omegas that are sublevel sets of good enough functions. For simplicity, now I consider only continuous functions. With some complications, we can consider also non-continuous. So the assumptions, of course, we need some regularity assumption, which is in order to avoid limitations with exponents, we take G in all W to P spaces. And a non-degeneracy condition, which is the following one, that 1 over the norm of the H gradient of G is in LP for every P bigger than 1. This is okay, this is a regularity condition. What is this condition? Let us recall in finite dimensions, if we want that the level sets, the level surfaces of G, for a smooth G, are smooth hypersurfaces, we impose that the gradient of G does not vanish at the level surface. Here we can allow that the H gradient of G vanish, but not too much, because otherwise this condition would be violated. Okay, and then we have this integration by parts formula. For every direction H in H, the integral over this omega of dHf is equal to the integral of omega on omega of H hat by F, and this is equal to what we had in the whole space, plus a boundary integral. And this is the integral over the set G equal to R of F by the scalar product between the normalized H gradient of G by H with respect to this surface measure rho. So we have a formula which is as similar as possible to what we had in finite dimensions. And well, here we can take F in some Sobolev space, and also, so the function to be integrated here is a Sobolev function again, and we have no Sobolev embeddings, so it is not continuous in general, and also under these assumptions one can see that the level set G equal to R is negligible with respect to gamma. So this is to be interpreted not pointwise, it's not meaningful, but in the sense of traces. And in fact, in this paper, we studied and we proved that it's possible to well define and study the traces of Sobolev functions on regular hypersurfaces. So this has to be intended in this function is the trace of this product at the boundary. Well, examples of admissible sets omega such that these conditions hold are, first of all, we can take as G an element of X star, so we have half spaces. Then, more generally, we can consider subgraphs of smooth enough functions defined on one codimensional subspaces of X. And if we are in a Hilbert space, we can consider also balls, any ball, and more generally, ellipsoids. Okay, and now let me describe the Malliaven approach. And well, I consider a slight generalization, which is clear from the Malliavent paper, all Malliavent paper, instead of taking the space of continuous function, we can consider any abstract linear space, namely any separable Banach space with a good Gaussian measure. And the function g, of which we shall consider the level sets, should be very smooth, wkp for every k and p, plus the same non-degeneracy condition that I mentioned before. Then, step one, one has to prove that the Borel measure in R induced by G, namely gamma of I is equal to gamma of G minus 1 of I, is absolutely continuous with respect to Lebesgue measure, with a smooth density Q1. So this means that the measure gamma of G minus 1 of Y, which is this integral, is equal to the integral over y of this function q1 of xi dxi. Dxi is the Lebesgue measure for every Borel set in R. More generally, one shows that for every good phi from x to a good for Malliavent means belonging to all wkp spaces, there exists a smooth, again, a smooth density q phi, such that the integral over g minus 1 of I of phi with respect to gamma is equal to the integral over I of q phi of xi dxi for every Borel set I. So we have a candidate to be a surface integral. It's this limit. We consider the limit when epsilon goes to 0 of 1 over 2 epsilon, the integral of phi on the slice g between r minus epsilon and r plus epsilon. Because of the proposition before, this can be written as the limit of 1 over 2 epsilon of r in the integral between r minus epsilon and r plus epsilon of q phi of xi dxi. Since q phi is smooth, in particular, it's continuous, and this limit is precisely q phi at r. And, for people used to handle the Minkowski content, this is just a generalization of the Minkowski content. Okay, but in any case, this is just a remark. We can do this only for very smooth phis. So for the moment, we have not a measure, but the second step is to show that, in fact, there exists a measure sigma rg, which is concentrated on g equal to r on the level surface, such that q phi of r is equal to the integral of phi with respect to this surface measure, at least for smooth phi. But there is a problem. The problem is that this sigma gr, because of this construction, depends on g. It's not universal. This is not due to the infinite dimension. If you do this in finite dimensions, you find the same problem. And so we have to modify something to rescale, or the right rescaling is to introduce a weighted measure, namely to consider this measure sigma gr multiplied by the H norm of gradient G. This is independent of G. So we have a good candidate to be this sigma R. And it's possible to show, again, that an integration by parts formula holds for smooth phi and for every H in the Cameron-Martin space. So we have this formula, which is quite similar to what we had, with the surface measure by Feyel and de la Pradelle. This is equal to this, this is equal to this. So these boundary integrals are the same for smooth phi. And this is enough to show that these measures do coincide, or better, the measure sigma r constructed by this method is just the restriction of the measure rho to the level set g equal to r. So they are two different ways to construct the same measure, at least on good surfaces. Now, okay, we revisited in a recent paper, we revisited the Romalia-Venn approach, and we gave completely different proofs, in fact. And giving proofs, completely different proofs, we could also consider less restrictive assumptions of G, these ones. But what's more interesting is that we could generalize our approach to our situations, namely to non-Gaussian probability measures, for the moment in Hilbert spaces. And if I have time, I will describe something about this later. But what I wanted to do now is to compare this approach with the geometric measure theory approach. This is possible because there are recent, or not very recent papers, but there are papers about bounded variation functions in abstract Venus spaces. And by definition, a Borel set in X has a finite perimeter if and only if its characteristic function is a bounded variation function. What are bounded variation functions in this setting? This means that there exists an H-valued measure, M, such that we have this general integration by parts formula. The integral over omega of the HF is equal to the integral of H hat by F with respect to gamma, plus this integral over x, f, the scalar product between h and n. For every good f, say c1b, and for every h in the Cameron-Martin space. This is equivalent to say that the supremum of the integral over omega of the Gaussian divergence of phi is finite, when phi varies in good h-valued vector fields, and the phi of x, the norm, the h norm of phi of x is less or equal than 1 for every x. Now, what's the Gaussian divergence? It is minus the adjoint in L2 of the h gradient. And it can be written more explicitly. Namely, one considers an orthonormal basis of H, which is separable as X is. And then if we have a vector field, a good vector field, we rewrite phi of X as the sum of phi j of X Hj, when phi j of X is the scalar product of capital phi of X by Hj. And the Gaussian divergence is given by this series. The series of dhj phi j minus h hat j phi j. This converges in all LP spaces. And so if omega has finite perimeter, this h-valued measure m has this polar decomposition. It's given by an h-valued unit vector field, n of x, by a positive measure, modulus of dm, which is the total variation measure of m, and this is called the perimeter measure. Okay, so these are the definitions. Let me give examples. The first example of set with a finite perimeter is the set that I considered before. Omega is the sublevel set of a good function G in all W2P spaces with this non-degeneracy condition. And this, in this case, we have our integration by parts formula that I described you before. And then this is true for every F in C1B and for every H in the Cameron-Marty space. Therefore, the definition holds. The characteristic function of G less than R is a bounded variation function. And the vector field N in the polar decomposition of the perimeter measure is just the normalized H gradient of G, because this is this is just the scalar product between the normalized H gradient on G and H. And modulus of dm is just the Hausdorff-Gauss measure of Ayer and de la Pradelle, its restriction to the level surface G equal to R. And another example that does not satisfy these assumptions in general is in this paper, and we proved that every open convex set has finite perimeter. And we didn't use this because we don't have this nice representation formula, but we proved that condition two holds. And therefore, we have this. Okay, and let me describe a bit what we did in our extension of the Mallien-Venn approach to non-Gaussian probability measures in Hilbert spaces. We tried to understand which are the main points that let one do this construction. So we have some abstract assumptions, which, however, can be checked in several examples. So the first abstract assumption is there is a bounded operator such that the gradient, or more generally, R by gradient, seen as an unbounded operator in a space LP with domain C1B and with values in LP XR, with values in X, is closable. And the closure for every P bigger than one. And the closure is denoted by MP. The domain of the closure is our Sobolev space, W1P X gamma. Another assumption is that for every p bigger than 1 and for every z in x, there is a constant such that the modulus of the integral over x of the scalar product between r gradient of phi and z is estimated by this constant by the norm of phi in LP for every phi in C1b. And this is equivalent to say that the constant vector fields f of x equal to z for every x belong to domain of the adjoint operator of MP, to the domain of MP star for every p. And so for every z, there exists an element vz, which is in LP prime of x nu for every p, so it's in LP for every p, which is MP star z, that plays this role in the integration formula. The integral over x of mp phi by z is equal to the integral over x of vz by phi for every phi in this Sobolev space. And third, a condition on the function g, which sublevel sets we will consider. G is in the intersection of all these W1P spaces. We take again, it continues for simplicity, and such that this vector field, MPG divided by its square norm, belongs to the domain of MP star, the adjoint of MP, for every P bigger than 1. I have to say that condition 2, in fact, implies condition 1, and to construct a surface measure, we need only 1 and 3. To have a good integration by parts formula, we need condition 2. Okay, so we assume that all of them hold. And then it's possible, we proved that for every R, there are surface measures, sigma GR, such that for every phi in C1B and for every Z in X, the integral over the set of the g of x less than r of the scalar product mp phi by z is equal to the integral over the same set of vz phi with respect to nu plus the integral over g equal to r or phi by the scalar product mp g by z with respect to this surface measure. And again, this surface measure depends explicitly on g, and again, we have to normalize in some sense then. So what we consider is the are the normalized surface measures, rho r, given by sigma rg by the norm of mg. This is mg. Mpg, g belongs to all Sobolev spaces, W1p, and so these operators mp agree. So I can call it mg. And these measures are independent of g, and the integration formula reads as follows. It's just dividing here by the norm of mpg here. And okay. So again, it has a form which is similar to what we had in the case of Gaussian measures. And well, in the case that nu is a Gaussian measure, centered on the general Gaussian measure, the space H, it's the range of Q1 half, where Q is the covariance of mu. And so one sees easily that 1 and 2 hold when R, the operator R, is Q1 half. And there are no novelties, because what we get is precisely the same surface measure that I discussed before. There are other examples. The first example is a weighted Gaussian measure. So we take mu, a good Gaussian measure, by a weight W of X with a good weight. And again, if we take R equal to Q to one half, where Q is the covariance of mu, we have no surprises, because what we get is that our surface measure, rho R, is just the surface measure of Fayel de la Pradelle, the restriction to the level set G equal to R multiplied by the weight W. So again, no surprise. And but there are very different measures that have nothing to do with Gaussian measures. In particular, it's possible to construct a family of non-Gaussian product measures in L2 that satisfy all these assumptions. And more importantly, some invariant measures of stochastic partial differential equations satisfy these assumptions. In particular, we can consider reaction diffusion equations with polynomial nonlinearities, and also the stochastic Barger's equation in dimension one. And in all these cases, the operator R has to be a power of the Dirichlet-Laplacian, or minus the Dirichlet-Laplacian, and for a suitable beta bigger than zero. And everything here works. And in these cases, we can take as function g the scalar product of x and b with b different from zero. So we have integration by parts formulae on half spaces. And also g of x equals the norm of x to the square satisfy our assumptions. And so we have also integration by parts formulae on balls. And well, this is what we did up to now. This has to be improved in several directions. First of all, one should consider finite codimensional surfaces. We have only one codimensional surfaces, but it's interesting to have also finite codimensional surfaces, which gives us some technical problems, but it's possible to do that. And something that should be improved or changed is this condition on G. Why? This condition of G is not very easy to be satisfied, because regularity is not a problem. What is difficult here, and in our examples, what we reduced to check this, we reduced to check that 1 over the norm of MPG belongs to all LP spaces. This is difficult in general. For a measure, for a general probability measure, it's not trivial. And So what we should do is to try to avoid this condition, or to replace it by something which is more easy to check, that will not give a precise integration by parts formula, but in any case, instead of having this nice boundary term, maybe we have something else which may be useful not for everything, but which may be used. Okay, and I stop here, and thank you for your attention.